Welcome back. Now, technology and innovation have for long been rendered by many a male thing, but over the years, women have defied this belief. Susan Mujeni, a graduate of business computing who majored in database management, is tech savvy and has developed an app called FunaRide for you who is seeking to travel. Despite discouragement from her friends, she says the business has slowly started picking up and she's starting to make money. How to make money?
My name is Susan Mujeni Ataremwa. I am a wife, a mom, and a founder of FunaRide. So I'm a tech entrepreneur. FunaRide is a car sharing app. It literally connects passengers and drivers in the same area code heading to the same destination. Like you're in Chireka, you are going to Iganga, so and you have a car, we can connect you. If you have subscribed with us, we can connect you to the number of people that you would like to travel with. If you have space for three people, we connect you to people that are in Chireka, between Chireka and Iganga, heading to the same destination or direction. You can get people to go to Mkono, Jinja, the direction you're heading to. There's no inconvenience. You don't get off the road. Just drop off people on the road, like particular stages. Generally, you work like a taxi.
Okay.
Yes, but right. In your car.
Okay, so how long have you done this business? And as a woman, oh, you said you're a tech entrepreneur. What really inspired you into joining the transport one instead? Because there's many platforms that you would have probably thought about. Why would you choose the transport one?
As an entrepreneur, I think it's all about solving a problem. An existing problem, and actually that's what usually happens to me, because I tend to identify problems in all areas. So it's basically not about transport alone. As a tech student, you know, it all began when I became a tech student. I graduated as a business bachelor's in business computing from Makerere University Business School a few years ago. Can't say so that you know my age. So I did bachelor's in business computing, majored in database management. It's during that time that I realized that you could actually solve a lot of problems with technology, because my final project was an information system. A management system, for a library management system, where you could, instead of using files and all that, as looking at how can we create a system that can have all this information digitally rather than keep piling up files. So it was with that background that I knew that you could solve a lot of problems with just a click on your phone. So, how did I join the transport sector? I drive a lot. I'm a salesperson in technology. I was blessed to join Wananchi Group. It's a technology group with SimbaNet, Zuku, iSat Africa. So joining Wananchi opened my mind up to a lot of technology solutions in security, in internet connectivity, in cloud. So being in the technology world, the only area that I usually look at is how can we solve problems in the technology world. Yeah, so basically, so I was driving home, and with that background in technology, and with my African, especially Ugandan traditional setting, where we always give lifts to neighbors, friends, acquaintances. I grew up in that kind of setup of extended family. You're traveling to Mbarara. Oh, can you take my daughter to Mbarara for me? Can you take her to school for me? Are you heading this? Can you drop her off? So it was that, this is that environment. And so when I also got my own car, I always never left neighbors, like on the road or at home, or we are going to church, I give rides. So it was one of those, because of that kind of background, I was driving home and I always saw people early morning, driving alone in the car, going to work, driving back home in the evening, going to, then they are stranded. The morning, people are struggling for taxis. In the morning, festive seasons, they're struggling to get taxis. With that in mind, I thought, how can someone give rides to strangers without worrying about security? Because you just can't pick up people on the road to drop them off without knowing who they are. So that's how that idea was born.
You know, you talk about picking up people, you know, strangers off the road and driving them, you know, not worrying about safety. So where is the safety in this? If I own a car and I enroll or take up the app and join your team, where is the safety for the other guy that I'm picking on the road, random four people that I'm picking and putting them in the same car?
Well, truth is, just like any technology solution, it's difficult to guarantee 100% safety. However, we can at least say 85 to 90%, you will at least you'll be safe. How? When you are registering for this app, you fill in your details. If you're a driver, we expect you to upload, of course, you put in your email, your registered telephone contact, your driving permit and your national ID, and the names and the details should tally, because that's why we give a few days for verifications to see are the details that you uploaded tally with the number that you gave us. Now, if they tally, then we trust the information you've given us. If they do not tally, then we do not approve. We do not give you the permission to use our app. We shall reject and give you a reason so that you go back and organize your paperwork. Now, for a passenger, we don't get into detail of uploading this, uploading that. Just like all the other ride hailing, we expect you to upload your, to write your names and upload and put in your details of your phone. So we expect that your names are tallying with the names on the phone.
Okay.
So basically, that's the only security. And of course, if you're using the app, we can be able to get a report on what time with who was traveling with this kind of car. If you have a problem with the UBH088R, we shall be able to tell that Sam or any other, like Sam was traveling with Paul, with Peter, in this kind of car, heading to this, and the driver was this, and all those details in the car. So at least there's ability to trace the people, rather than just picking people randomly on the stage.
All right, so you know, there's this obvious question that someone will ask. So what is the difference between Funaride and Uber?
Well, the difference between Funaride and Uber is basically, Funaride is so Ugandan, I would say. It derives its business model from the Ugandan idea of giving different people rights. Like, its model is of a taxi. You have a car, you subscribe with us. Anytime you're going to a particular place, we connect you to people heading to the same direction. You don't have, for Uber, as you can see, its model is for hiring purely. You alone, or you hire for a group of people, but it is you alone. But for Funaride, you say if you're traveling with someone else, the driver does not get out of their route, and they are not hired to drop people home. Now, when you do that, the risk is on you. We only connect drivers to passengers. If I'm traveling from, for example, from Chireka to Mbale, and I'm a driver, and I go on the app, I'll put in Chireka to Mbale, my car needs three people. I'm traveling tomorrow, 8th at 8. Now, Funaride will give you different people that are between Chireka, either nearby you in Chireka or between Chireka and Mbale. So you don't get off your route, but you pick up people on stages. You don't need to get off to pick people from home or that. On the contrary, Uber picks everyone from their home and drops them wherever they are going. So it's purely different. This is a shared platform. The intention is for sharing costs. But for Uber, it is purely for earning, like kind of special. Okay. So yes, the driver makes some extra bucks, but it's not as expensive as to the passenger as hiring a full car, because the costs are shared with the passengers.
Okay, right. So we're talking about making some bucks. The segment is called How to Make Money. Let's now talk about how the actual making of the money happens then. If I am taking the car, or if I'm getting a lift,
yes.
Just paint for us a picture. If I were going from here to Mbara, and I had to use a bus, and then if I were to use Funaride, you know, connected car, where would I get, how does the discount come in, and about how much would I save off?
Well, usually, as Funaride, we emphasize on conveniency, flexibility, and of course, cost effectiveness. So compared to using a bus, the bus, you definitely need to travel to go to the bus park, pay ticket and all that, and you go at the pace of the bus. If you need to stop anywhere, you will have to wait for the bus to stop somewhere, not you. On the contrary, I have personally used Funaride services traveling to Mbara sometime. I just booked a ride on Funaride, and I traveled like as in a private car, basically general as in a private car. The cost can be a bit less by 5,000 if the cost is 30,000 for a bus. In most cases, you find most drivers say like 5,000 less or exact. But what makes it different from the bus is that you don't have to struggle to get into the bus park. You meet where it is convenient for the both of you, because now it is a negotiation of you picked me, you're traveling to Mbara and you're coming from Chireka, you can find me on Chambogo and we go. Or you can use Kamuli Road and pick me up from somewhere. So it is convenient for the passenger, and for the entrepreneur, for the driver, he makes some money off, because instead of fueling the car alone and traveling alone, he could even doze off. You need company, and you need the cost, the lessened cost on travel. Lastly, for the entrepreneur, we are brokers. As Funaride, we connect. We don't own vehicles. We do not know the passengers, but we connect the passenger to the driver. So the driver gives us a small commission of 10%. If you make 30,000, just give us 3,000. If you make 100,000, just give us 10. It's not a lot to maintain, for the business to run. We need to cover our costs, hosting the servers, pay our employees, all these other costs. So we are purely brokers. However, we help the passenger to travel conveniently. There's flexibility where I'll stop and you're like, you know what? Stop at this restaurant, I want to go for a short call, anything. You go comfortable, like you're in your own car, but someone else driving you.
Okay.
Then for the driver, you don't spend a lot on fuel. Your sharings, actually, the passengers can cover your entire fuel, and you only do driving. Yeah. So.
All right, so you are, you know, making about 2 years soon.
We're
somehow making, as an entrepreneur, do you think you're making some business sense of the time you started?
Yes, we have not yet actually started making profit, but at least there's some little money coming in to maintain a few costs. Though, of course, we need more money to inject in. There's updates, the addition of features and hosting and all that. But there is some little money that we generate from the people that are using the app already. And yes, the only challenge is people not knowing about the app. But whoever finds about it, there's a group of women I'm actually trying to connect and encouraging them to download, because we are having something tomorrow. So people not everyone needs to drive a car, and yet you're all coming from similar area codes and you're heading to the same destination or direction. Why do like 100 women have to drive cars when you're actually going to the same place? So it makes people are warming up to the idea of using a phone, technology. It is WhatsApp, all these things made it easier for people to know that you can actually use a phone. So So people are warming up to technology slowly by slowly. It's just changing mindsets. And I see that the more people get to find out, the more they are downloading the app and the more they are using it.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's just basically whoever hears about it wants to download and use it.
Okay, so towards the end of 2020 is probably when you thought about this idea and
yes.
you started it, and then COVID happened.
Yes.
How did it feel, given that you're just having this idea that you thought would be very brilliant, and then all of a sudden the transport sector is shattered?
It was actually crazy. However, an entrepreneur, I think, has a tough skin for challenges. When all that happened, I looked at it as an opportunity. It was a challenge.
Okay.
Because it gave us opportunity for everyone to sit at home and concentrate on, now we were using Google Meet or all these other platforms to communicate, Zoom, to communicate with my developers, with the team, on how we can improve our app. So a lot of changes happened during that period that we were not able to, because we had just actually like uploaded and things happened. So we didn't have time to even advertise. And when they would open a bit and we tried to advertise, everyone was like, who takes people in the car when there's COVID? Yeah. However, we looked at it in a way of businesses are shutting down. People need money. People are struggling, actually. Car owners are struggling. So you find that even with the risk of COVID, someone needs some extra money. You know, vehicles are an essential part of life. We need the vehicles. It's no longer luxury. It's difficult to travel without cars. So when you have one and you can at least share the cost of maintaining it, the better, rather than selling it off because you can't afford to even move with fuel.
All right, at the start of the interview, you told us you're a mom, and which certainly makes you a woman. And this week, you know, the women celebrated National Women's Day. Just talk to us a bit about women in business, the ups and downs, and where do you see women in business generally?
Women, it's tough being a woman in business, and it gets tougher when you are in tech. You see, even in my work, I am in tech. I've been in tech selling technology. As a tech startup, it is tough for a woman. Why? I will even give you an example of the guys I work with. I happen to work, it is kind of a male-dominated area, technology, and there's a lot of male chauvinism. My brothers or my husband, they tend to think that technology is a male area. Like, how do you even concentrate on that? They push it down. When I would go to sell to some customers on technology, talking about security, about internet connectivity and all, sometimes, actually most cases, you find that I am, like, my male customers might not believe me. They'll buy the person, they like what I'm as Susan, but they will ask you for an expert opinion from the male counterpart. Being the salesperson that I am, I don't take offense in it. I'll call a male engineer to give them details on what they want, which I actually already explained to you. Now, when I come to this area, it's tough as an entrepreneur, as a tech woman in business. When you come to funding, the funding, they tend to say it is a leveled field. But when we actually go to pitch, the male entrepreneur is believable more than the female entrepreneur. They actually give more, even in employment, if you're to follow it up, a tech employee earns less than that. You're the same level, but the salary scale is different. You will come bargaining for a particular salary scale, they push you to a particular level. Your male counterpart comes, they give him a higher salary pay. It's tough in technology for a woman.
Well, from Susan's story, you see how one thing is for sure: focus, focus, and focus. Now it's time for our personal finance, and we show you how investing in agribusiness can boost your income.
Hello, Augustine Tamale are my names, and the last time we talked about passive income, we mentioned the various types, that is the stocks on the securities exchange, the bonds, and we also elaborated on the fixed deposits. And then we moved on into active income, and we mentioned employment. You need to find a job. If you don't have capital, find a job and then start saving for capital. You will do a mixture of your savings and borrowings in order to invest into other sources of active income, and that included business. And we did mention that don't get into a business that you haven't researched about. Find out where the markets are, how the inputs are acquired, so that you can ably succeed in running this business. And your physical presence helps to minimize the losses. There will always be some losses here and there, but your presence minimizes them. Well, so employment income and then business income. The next active income is agribusiness. Agribusiness is so good here in Uganda. We have an excellent weather. Oh, excellent climate in this country. It's so wonderful that we have two harvest seasons. So when you get into it, you know that you'll have produce to sell twice a year. That is if you're handling the fast growing crops like beans, things like maize, you'll harvest twice a year. So this is an important business to get into. It requires you to first study as well. If you just do agriculture for consumption, you are only minimizing your expenses. We will handle that another time. Today we are looking at agriculture as a business. You need to get information from those who are actively farming. You know, the theory differs from the practicals. There is a great difference between the theory and the practicals. So you must deal with the people who are actively farming to understand the current challenges in agriculture. Which pests are there? How should the land be fertilized? Where are the markets for the produce? Where are the markets? And then, how much should you spend in production? How much should you spend? Because you might spend a lot of money in weeding, you might spend a lot of money in other inputs, which money will not be received via the sales that you're going to make. So you should have a rough estimate of how much you're going to earn or how much you're going to harvest per acre. Once you've got that from those who are practically involved in farming, then you move to the people of theory. You need it as well, because the other people may be missing a bit. So once you get that from the educated people, these agricultural scientists, these veterinary scientists, once you learn what they have as well, you look at what those practical farmers told you and see the gap. Then you ask the practical farmers that, what about this? How come you're not doing it? They give you their reasons. Get back to these scientists and ask them more questions, basing on what the farmers have told you. Once you ask them, they're going to elaborate, and then you'll get into agriculture successfully. Let me tell you, if you're in your personal home and you can even have some chicken there, this local chicken, it is helpful. But even on your farm, even if you are cultivating beans and you have chicken, it's going to help you a lot. They will fertilize, their droppings are going to fertilize the land, but they self-multiply. I was looking at a young boy who started off with just about two chicken, a cock and a hen, about 3 years back. Right now, that boy has close to 40 local chicken, 40. And he's not having an input in them. They just keep multiplying. Next year, a number of those females will have given birth and he will be now in 100 plus. So that helps you. Mix it. Don't just do crop farming. Have mixed farming so that you can benefit from the dumpings or the excreta from the animals and birds to fertilize the land. Because again, the animal manure is expensive. If you can get part of it by yourself, it will help you. So the study must go on step by step into agriculture so that you can understand how to benefit from it. If you're going to do the exotic breeds, those ones require much more research because they are sensitive. They are vulnerable to diseases. So you must understand how to handle them.
As it's always said that Uganda is one of the best agriculture countries. If you focus on agribusiness, you might make more income than you expected. We are now going to take a look at our Forex and market report. Beyoncé Knowles once said, "The most alluring thing in a woman is confidence." Well, despite all the hurdles in life, never lose your confidence as a woman. Thank you very much. That's all we had time for tonight on The Business Show. Thanks again for making time. I'll see you next time. Good night.